Good evening, everybody, and welcome to this edition of History and Highballs as part of the North Carolina Museum of History's History at Home Initiative. We're so glad that you're joining us for this evening's program, History and Highballs, Oysterman's Calling. My name is Stacey, and I handle adult education over at the museum. So whenever you sign up to join us for one of these History and Highballs programs, you and I will virtually get to spend the evening together, listening to some incredible stories about North Carolina places and people and what makes our state so special. Tonight's program is just one of many exciting virtual offerings available through MOH. So if you'd like to learn more about our History at Home initiative, head over to the museum's website at www.ncmuseumofhistory.org. We would like to take this opportunity to thank our North Carolina Museum of History Associates and Foundation for making tonight's program possible. Our associates and foundation provide crucial funding and support to the museum, which in addition to many, many other things, helps make programming like this evening's event happen. If you'd like to learn more about becoming an associates member, please head over to their website at www.ncmoha.com. We would also like to take this opportunity to thank those of you who graciously donated funds towards this evening's program. We do our best to keep our programs free to attend, but there are costs associated with keeping these series going, and we continue to be so appreciative of your generous support of the museum and its programs. So thank you so much. A few quick housekeeping items for this evening. We ask that you please keep your mics muted throughout the entirety of tonight's event. And to please type any questions that you have for our guest speaker into the chat function located at the bottom center of your screen. At the end of the program, I will ask our speaker as many of your questions as time allows. All right, so it is my honor to introduce this evening's speaker, Ryan Bethea, owner, operator, and oysterman of Oysters, Carolina. The education of oysterman and teacher Ryan started on land with one brave slurp. Now his sustainably harvested Harker's Island oysters are prized throughout the state. His company, Oysters, Carolina, is dedicated to providing the people of North Carolina with the freshest shellfish in the state. All of his oysters are pulled from the water the day they are delivered directly to you. Their award-winning oysters are also consistently rated one of the saltiest in the entire U.S. with an average salinity of 31 to 33 PPT. Is that right, Ryan? North Carolina has the best shellfish and Oysters Carolina has the freshest. All right. Welcome, Ryan. Thanks so much for joining us.
Thanks for having me, Mrs. Smith. All right. You know, I wish I could see you guys, but I appreciate you all coming and thank you so much for having me. So I figured what I'm going to do is just kind of give a short rundown of how I got here, a little bit about me, and then we'll talk about cocktails, we'll talk about oysters, we'll talk about the eating and all that, the good stuff about oysters, we'll really nerd out. We'll talk about some polyploidy. We're going to talk about the life cycle of oysters, things like that. And then, you know, we're going to get to answer some questions. So again, thanks for having me. So I'm Ryan Bethea from Oysters, Carolina, and I'm from Durham, born and raised, a proud person from Durham, and grew up there, went to Hillendale Elementary, Brogdon Middle School, and Riverside, if there's some Triangle folks listening in. After that, I traveled around. I got into service industry, so I have a service industry background. I did bartending, mostly fine dining, and just traveled around the Southeast, everywhere from Florida to Louisiana, you know, and all around North Carolina as well, and really got a good grasp of kind of wine, cocktails, fine dining, food, all that stuff. Then I kind of had an epiphany one day working at a place that I didn't feel good about what I was doing with my life. I didn't feel like I was helping people. Not that those folks aren't, especially nowadays, but I just felt like I wanted to do something different and decided to get into teaching. So I had a degree from geography, a geography degree, a BS with a little bit of GIS in there, and from the University of Central. Go Eagles, go Durham. with that, if you in North Carolina, because there's such a shortage of teachers, if you have a certain degree with a certain GPA, you can actually teach while you're earning your teaching certificate. So decided I was going to teach, you know, put a resume out there. There's actually a portal for that. And I got a call back the same day from a guy named Dr. Lovett, who I consider a mentor. I went in for an interview the next day, and then I started teaching. So I had a bar shift on Friday, and then Wednesday I started teaching. So it was a huge shift for me, especially as someone who got in a lot of trouble at school. I was fortunate enough to be able to teach eighth grade. So I taught eighth grade social studies and science. Had a great time, loved the kids. I was at a Title I school in Franklin County, which is right north of Wake County. And had a blast. After that, or while I was doing that, I started the business, Oysters Carolina. So I would work 5 days a week. And then on the weekends, we'd go down to the farm and work. And it was a lot, but it was a good way to kind of not have to either raise a lot of capital or you know, take investors. And so here we are now. All right, that's the boring stuff, right? Let's get into some cocktails. So I know you guys, I saw the cocktail that went out to y'all. It's a super cool looking cocktail. I used to work at a place in Durham called Blue Seafood next to Vin Rouge. So if there's anybody out here that's been to Blue Seafood, you know, if you sat at the bar, I probably saw you. But the reason I'm telling you that is because I would sell oyster shooters like crazy. We'd crush it. So we would just take the Bloody Mary mix, put it in like a shaker with a little bit of ice and some vodka. Strain that into a shot glass, then take an oyster, shuck it right into there and shoot it. And it was a lot of fun. So, you know, I hope you guys are enjoying your cocktails. It seems really neat. What I'm drinking tonight is I'm drinking a gin Vesper. All right. So this is a super underrated drink. I love Vespers, but you don't see a lot of people get them. So I'm just going to kind of quickly go over how to make that. And then I've got some special gin that I'm going to show you as well. So a Vesper is just a martini. All right. So it's just going to have vermouth and vodka or gin. All right. So for the people out there that like a little bang for their buck, this has got plenty of it. Okay. So the vermouth I like to use is called Lillet. Okay. Lillet. It's French. It's going to be, you either have to order at the ABC store or wine shops have it, like Total Wine and stuff. So get this stuff. It's delicious. All right. What I do is I take the glass. Okay. I pour a little Lillet in there. I do like this and then I dump it out. So that's called a rinse. Okay. So I do that. Also, for the guys out there, and the guys and the gals that are scared of breaking a martini glass and don't like it, look, just get your martini strained into a rocks glass. So there's no ice, it's just strained in there, and it looks really cool. Some might say a little sexy as well. So get your martini strained into a rocks glass. So we do the rinse with a Lillet, okay? And then I special ordered some gin. So this stuff is called Empress Gin. It's from the UK. And this is why it's special. Look at this stuff. It's purple. That's not the bottle. The actual gin is purple. Okay. Really neat stuff. You know, obviously, you know, this comes from the butterfly pea flower. Okay. That's how it's purple. And then it's got grapefruit and other botanicals in there. So what we did is we took the Lillet to rinse. Okay. Then we poured a little bit more into a shaker. Then we added this wonderful Empress gin, a lot of ice, and then I like martinis bruised. So bruised just means you shake it really, really hard, okay? So put it in there with a lot of ice, and then here's a bartender secret, add a little bit of water, and it's gonna taste a lot better. So people are sometimes gonna think if you water down a cocktail, you're not adding as much liquor. Add as much liquor as you want, okay? Make it as strong as you want, but add the water, it'll kind of make it easier. You know, it's not going to be as straight gin right in your mouth. Okay. So a splash of water, then for this particular Vesper, got a grapefruit. Okay. You make a twist out of it. You take your glass, your rim, twist it up, do that. And then this is the cocktail that you get. It's purple. It's crazy looking. So cheers to y'all. Woo. Man, all right. Really getting this thing going. Thanks everybody that's saying cheers. The other thing I brought, or that I have right here, I think is really cool. I'm just going to quickly talk about it, is we have an oyster beer. So we've made four different types of beer with our oysters. And I'm proud of each one of them. And the way that an oyster is going to contribute to the beer is in two ways, okay? The first way is going to be the salinity, right? Probably what you would assume. So if you take a whole oyster, that water that's inside an oyster, when you shuck it, that's called oyster liquor. And it's the same salinity as the surrounding waters. You would just put whole oysters into the batch. And when those oysters, you know, get cooked and open up, all that salinity is going to get into there, and it's going to add some salinity to your beer. So the one we use where they really focus on salinity was a brewery in Charlotte called Wooden Robot. And we made an oyster goes. So if you know anything about goes, is they're sour with a little bit of salinity. It's kind of a perfect summertime drink. So we use oysters for that. The second thing you can use oysters for are the shells, right? So we're going to talk about it when we talk about sustainability, but the shells are made of calcium carbonate. So that's going to give kind of a mouthfeel to it, kind of a silky mouthfeel. And we've made a smoky oyster stout. We've made another oyster stout as well, which is probably more common that you've probably seen in stores. And they've been delicious. So the one that I brought today is a different kind of oyster beer. Okay. All right. It's called Who Will Drink This When We're Gone? This is out of Casita. So if you haven't tried any Casita beers, try it. These guys are awesome. They used to brew in Farmville. Now they have a new brewery in Wilson by the Whirligigs. And I love this stuff. Okay. They make really, really good beers. This beer is made with our oysters. This is an oyster milkshake IPA. All right. So, you know, I don't drink a ton of milkshake IPAs, but this one is actually really, really good. So if you can see what's in it, there's pineapple, lime, and some oysters, as well as some other things, and marshmallows as well. That's what kind of gives it the milkshake thing. So this right here, if you can find any more of it, get it. If not, just drink stuff from Casita because it's delicious. Okay. So that's that. One more quick thing about cocktails, cocktail sauce, oyster shooters, things like that. I just wanted to mention, I tried to find out where cocktail sauce came from because, you know, shrimp cocktail, oysters cocktail, it actually started in the 1890s and or the only written down recipes in the 1890s. What they would do, you know, oysters were a lot more prevalent then. You would go to a place that was serving oysters or serving drinks, and maybe for lunch or for breakfast, they would chuck either half a dozen or a dozen oysters into a glass, right? Like into a pint glass like this. That's pretty weird. Okay, shuck them in there. They'd add ketchup, Worcestershire, horseradish, lemon, the stuff that's in cocktail sauce now. They'd put all that in there, stir it up, okay? And then people would drink it. So either drink all six oysters, drink a little bit, chew it up, swallow it. And as you can imagine, that's, you know, the energy you're going to get from crushing, you know, 6 to 12 oysters with just some cocktail sauce, is really going to get you through the day. So that's where cocktail sauce came from. So there you go. You learned that. All right. To get a little nerdy, we're going to start out and talk about how, we're just going to talk about the beginning of oysters all the way to the end of oysters when you get them. Okay. So what starts out is you take two oysters, right? Hopefully a male and a female. The way you would determine that is you would collect a bunch of different oysters, We've done that on our farm. We've worked with some kids from NC State. They've come out to our farm. They've taken 20 oysters. That's it. So there's wild oysters growing all over the oyster cages because the cages are just in the middle of the bay. You know, farmed oysters and wild oysters are very, very similar. So they're just growing all over the cages. We take them. We take them into a lab. They're sitting like this. All right. We take a little prick. We prick the gonad of the oyster, which is just, there's gonad kind of running through the entire mantle of the oyster. So most of the meat is going to contain gonad, right? So either sperm or egg. You prick that, you put it under the microscope, and you're going to see one of two things. Well, really one of three things. You're going to see sperm, looks like normal sperm, okay, that you would see from other species. You're going to see eggs as well. And then sometimes you're going to see both. And those oysters are hermaphroditic. About 15% of an oyster colony, right, an oyster rock or an oyster reef, are going to be hermaphroditic. The reason for that is oysters can change sexes. So when they're all, you know, naturally they shoot gonad out, okay, either shoot out sperm or egg. The other oysters can get a sense, okay, wow, the water has too much sperm in it or too much eggs in it, too many eggs in it. And so some of us need to switch one way or the other. So that's why, so sometimes you get them in the middle of switching and there's sperm and egg. So you take that, you know, you have the two oysters or however many oysters, you prick it. Okay, this one has sperm, this is a male. This one over here, we prick it, it's a female. Then you're going to take the oyster with, we do something called strip spawning. There's all different kinds of methods to do it, but you just take a scalpel, kind of scrape the top part of the oyster. All right, that gonad is going to go into a cup. You take the female oyster, same thing. Scrape the gonad into a cup with a little bit of saline solution, right? And you're going to look at that under a microscope and you're going to rate the sperm and the egg. So, you know, you're looking for the same things you would look for, you know, if anybody is rating sperm, not that you would, you know, motility, deformities, things like that. You're going to rank them on a 1 to 5, same with the lady eggs, 1 to 5. All right. And then you're going to use a formula to determine how much you should put together in a separate little tube, right? So if the sperm is a 3 and the eggs are a 1, then maybe put 10 milliliters of the sperm and maybe 2 milliliters of the eggs. You put that in there, you stir it up. All right. And then you've got like the mitosis happening. It's like this and it's splitting apart and it's creating larvae. It is amazing. It's amazing. So within the first 6 hours, it goes through lots of different phases, kind of in, you know, the best way to think of it is a circle. That first stage in 6 hours is a trochophore stage. So you do that, it's splitting trochophore. So kind of like a larval stage. Well, these are all technically larval stages, but there's no calcium carbonate. There's no shell around the larvae at this point. Next stage is the D stage. It's called a D stage because it looks like a D. Right? Just like that. So the shell is starting to form. Then it goes into something called a veliger stage. So a veliger is just an appendage with cilia on it for eating or for moving. Sometimes it's, you know, for moving around. Sometimes it's for eating food, algae and things like that. After the veliger stage, it's going to enter something called pediveliger. All right. You guys probably know what pedi is. It's like a foot. So it's actually going to have a little foot sticking out as well as like, you know, kind of like what a clam looks like, a little clam foot. So it's still going to have the two veligers and then the little foot. It's important to know right now, too, this stuff is just swimming around, okay? It's not become sessile yet. Oysters are sessile, right? They stick on something and then they grow, all right? These things are swimming around, all right? So it's remarkable that it even happens in the wild. So you've got a big oyster rock shooting out sperm, shooting out egg. They find each other in this gigantic thing of water with tides and wind and predators, okay? They start to forming, they go through all these stages. It takes about 2 weeks to go through those stages. So, you know, it's kind of a numbers game. You gotta put a lot of numbers out there because not a lot's gonna survive. Then when it has that pediveliger stage that we talked about, after about 2 weeks, the oyster is gonna develop an eye, which they lose this eye, so it's really bizarre. We don't really know much about it. And it's going to use different methods, whether it's sound, vibration, maybe the eye, to find some hard substrate to land on, okay? And then it's gonna start to grow, okay? So it's gonna lose that stuff, gonna lose the petty, the foot, it's gonna lose some of the veligers, okay? Do that and then start to grow like that. So that's kind of how, you know, I've been kind of going back and forth between lab and wild. So in the lab, you're doing all that, they're in tanks, okay? The water that's coming in is just filtered water, all right? It's the raw water from the outside. It goes through different filters, UV filter, charcoal filter, 1 micron, so really small screen filter. Lots of stuff still gets in there, let me tell you that. We use that water for that. So the oysters are swimming around in there. Then we do, in the wild, they find the hard substrate and they grow, okay? But we need to have oysters that are gonna be growing kind of uniformly. And, you know, we want them to look as pretty as possible, right? So what we do is we put them in something called a downweller. A downweller is just any kind of apparatus where the water moves from the top down the bottom. So it's a cylinder, it's got a screen on the bottom, let's say 20 microns, because the oysters are small. You put colch, which is just ground up oyster shell, sand-like, on there. You put the larvae in there, you raise the cylinder up, you have some dripping water or stream of water coming in here, okay? And it's gonna go out on this side. And what that does is it pulls the oyster kind of down towards it. And so it really initiates the oyster finding something hard to land on. So we actually fool the oyster. The oyster thinks it's landing on another oyster, right? That's oysters all kind of grow together in big clumps, all right? So it finds that little speck of shell, the colch, and it's, you know, okay, time to grow. So it does that, it loses that stuff, becomes sessile, and starts to grow on that in the downweller. So that's how you do it. Once you do that, you put it outside in a raceway. So just a long trough of water, okay, that's got cylinders in the middle of the trough. You put the oysters in there, and then this is called an upweller. So this is the little things, the cylinders here, those are called upwellers. What you're gonna do is you're gonna have a pipe up top, all right, that can flow into unimpeded outside, and it's going to be sitting in water. And what that does is it causes a vacuum for the water to actually come up and then through the tube. Okay, so you've got, you know, at some points millions of oysters in a tube about that big. Okay, a lot of oysters. So you need a lot of water going through there because oysters are pretty voracious eaters. So the water has got to really go through there, and they're growing at this point. They're growing half a millimeter a day, a millimeter, 2 millimeters a day, really, really fast. When you have a million oysters in a space this big, okay, and even if they just grow half a millimeter, doesn't seem like a lot, that's a million half millimeters that grew. So it's a lot. Once the oysters are in that stage, so it just looks like a little tiny baby oyster. It's about the size of your thumb, okay, 4 to 8 millimeters. They look like the regular oysters you'd see in a restaurant, except for they're just miniature. You take those and then you put them in whatever grow out you do. It might be hanging baskets, it might be a bag, might just be a cage at the bottom. There's all different kinds of methods for growing out. We use a cage that sits on a bottom because we're fortunate enough to have a nice sandy bottom, and we're intertidal as well. So, you know, you see oysters be exposed during low tide periods when the tide ebbs out. And so that's a natural thing for an oyster. So we like to grow the oysters in an area like that, and it kind of toughens them up, gets them stronger because they have to close, you know, a certain number of hours a day. That really strengthens the abductor muscle, which holds them tight. If we have a chance to go into oyster anatomy, I'll go over that. But yeah, so that's how an kind of the life cycle of an oyster that you would get. So kind of going back to with what we did on our farm with the Gitchermansi State, they took those oysters, they took 20 oysters, they went through that stage and that phase of the different things we just talked about, and they made 280,000 oysters from 20, okay? So when you talk about sustainability, you can't beat that. You take 20 out of the wild and you put back 280,000. That's a lot. It's amazing stuff. And sustainability is one of the really big reasons why we do this, and why oyster farming is, you know, kind of futuristic and something that we're going to be talking and hearing and seeing a lot more, you know, in the decades to come, kind of with people awakening to, you know, focusing on our planet. All right. So we hit a couple things. I'll just talk a little bit about at Oysters Carolina, what we do. So we have 5.25 acre of water. All right. So that's a nice size water. It's on the north side of Harker's Island in a place called Westmouth Bay. So Harker's Island at this part of the state runs east to west. So we're on the north side of it. And then Shackelford Banks is right here. All right. And then if you know Cape Lookout, the lighthouse that has the diamonds on it, that's over here. So about 2 miles away is Cape Lookout. With Harker's Island being like this, Shackelford being like this, we have tons of water coming in through the Cape, okay, where Cape Lookout is, coming out in the North River, which divides Beaufort and Harker's Island. A lot of y'all probably know Beaufort, okay? Morehead City, Atlantic Beach, that area. That river divides that. So we have salt water coming in from both sides. So there's a lot of flow through there. And so it's really difficult to grow oysters where we are. There's so much fresh ocean water that it makes our environment pretty much marine. So we rate salinity on parts per thousand, PPT, okay? That's the salt content in the water. So the Atlantic Ocean is 33 to 35 parts per thousand on average, and our farm is 31 to 33 parts per thousand. So it's pretty much marine. Kind of some problems that would bring, you know, one is biofouling. So we have all this macroalgae growing on everything, okay? Macroflora. It's, you know, you can imagine if something can be able to be alive in ocean water and thrive in ocean water with all that salt, then it's pretty hardy stuff. So all of our gear and everything gets covered in that stuff. So we're constantly cleaning the oysters. Another thing that does is that range of salinity is on the high end for oysters. So oysters, you know, they can't really go below 10 parts per thousand. That's really, really fresh. That's like, you know, middle part of the Neuse River fresh. If you know where Oriental, kind of in between Oriental and New Bern, like Havelock area, that's like 8 to 10 parts per thousand. Really, really fresh water. Okay. All the way, the high end is about where we are. We're about 33 parts per thousand. So the oysters, you know, it's on the higher end for them. So we get a lot more mortality. But what that does is the oysters that do come out of there are delicious. You know, people like salty oysters, and we get told by people, you know, all the time, they've been eating oysters for 50 years. This is the saltiest oyster they've ever had. I know this is kind of a cocktail and beer themed talk. And if, you know, it's good. It's perfect for beer, perfect for cocktails. They really are. They're nice and salty. So that's, you know, that's kind of how we do things there. So the oysters that are going to grow at our farm full time, again, this farm is in the middle of the bay. It's just like wild oysters. All right. We just take care of them. So they're in the middle of the bay. Okay. The ones that we grow there full time, those are called Beaucelles. It just means beautiful salt in French, right? Beaucelles. And then, you know, we recommend that for eating raw. So they're kind of delicate. They're boutique. You know, they're something you kind of see at a restaurant. They're fancy. So those are the ones we've won some awards with that. You know, we won Oyster of the Year with those. And so then we have another oyster that we grow as well. Those are called Native Sons. So those oysters are for roasting or grilling or any kind of cooking. If you like oysters Rockefeller, if you like char grilled oysters, then, you know, those are perfect for that. The way we grow those, because you need an area with lots of food and lower salinity to grow those big oysters. The way we grow those is we work with guys, either wild harvest guys, so guys that are out there tonging up oysters, okay? We either get oysters from them or we get oysters from other farmers that are growing them in low salinity areas. So it's a big, beautiful, fat oyster, but it's low salinity. And, you know, we just personally like a saltier oyster. So we take those oysters, we put them at the farm. All right. We just literally, you tong them up, you put them on a boat, you boat over to my farm, and you put them back in the water. And within about 6 hours, they've completely changed profile. All right. So they've gotten a lot saltier. So it really shows that an oyster is going to taste like it's miroir, right? They say miroir, they say terroir means, you know, earth. So, or of the earth or from the earth, however you want to translate it, you know, for wine. So each grape has its own flavor profile based on the soil it's grown. Oysters are the same way with miroir. So with whatever water they're grown in, whether they're wild or farmed, you know, that's how they get their flavor. I don't really know how much time I have, but Ms. Smith, if you'll tell me, but I'm just going to quickly dive into the difference between wild oysters and farmed oysters, because there are some, you know, there's a lot of information out there. A lot of people ask me that question, so I figured I'd kind of go over that.
Yeah, you've got about 15, 20 minutes.
Okay, great. I'll talk about this, and then we'll take questions. All right, so, you know, again, I'm bringing this up because we get to get a little nerdy with it. A lot of times we don't get to really get nerdy with the oysters, but it's amazing kind of the stuff that's happening out there. So I'd love to kind of share it with you. So we're going to talk about polyploidy, right? You thought it was boring enough before. Now it's really going to get boring. All right. So, so polyploidy is just how many chromosomes, you know, something has. Okay. Most things, other than like male honeybees and things like that, are diploids. Okay, so diploids means two, right? So it has two sets of chromosomes, all right? What a lot of people do for farmed oysters, okay, is you take an oyster with two chromosomes, okay, two sets of chromosomes, and you put it through there's different processes. You can heat it, you can do different things like this, okay, or different things to it, and that diploid is going to turn in those two sets of chromosomes is going to have now all of a sudden four sets of chromosomes. All right. That's called a tetraploid, right? Tetra, four sets. So now, instead of having a two chromosome oyster mating with the two chromosome oyster, you have a four chromosome oyster, tetraploid, mating with a two chromosome oyster, diploid. All right. The four and the two, it makes a three. All right, so the oysters that are going to come out of that are going to be called triploids, three sets of chromosomes. And those are kind of like mules, right? They're sterile. So we're finding a lot more out about them. We don't know much about them, but we're finding out that they actually do produce gonad, but they just don't release it. So the reason why you're saying, okay, why would you want to make an oyster that isn't going to reproduce, right? Well, the reason is because if the oyster doesn't spend all of its time creating gonad, right? Animals are meant to feed and another F word. That's it, right? Instinctual. So feed and intercourse. When you take the intercourse part away, it's just going to feed. So the oyster is going to grow faster and it's going to get to a larger size in under 2 years. You know, a wild oyster, for it to get about that big, a size that you would want to eat, it's going to take 2 years and older. Okay. For a farmed oyster, it's going to be less. The reason why 2 years is the cutoff is because a lot of oyster diseases, so MSX, not diseases that are hurtful to us, but diseases that'll kill the oyster, dermo, MSX. Okay. Those are the ones that we deal with our oyster species, Crastris rhea virginicus, the eastern oyster here in North Carolina. Those occur in the second year of life, all right? So if we can get those oysters onto a table, you know, to you for you to enjoy before they get, you know, hit with any oyster diseases, then that's great, all right? So that would be the difference between a wild oyster that's got two chromosomes and some farmed oysters, okay, that have three sets of chromosomes, triploids. Now, there are, for people that are like, well, that's GMO. First of all, it's not GMO because GMO is genetically modified. You're only genetically modifying a parent, okay? You're not genetically modifying the actual oyster. that you're going to be eating. And the second thing is, there's lots and lots of diploid oysters. Okay. We grow diploid oysters. Lots of guys grow diploid oysters. So those oysters that we talked about earlier, all right, with the NC State kids, they took the 20, remember the male and the female, took 20 out, 280,000 put back out there. Those oysters are very healthy because they came from our waters, right, naturally. And now they've got somebody taking care of them, me and one other guy. So these things are, they're perfect. They're delicious. They're, you know, those are the exact same as wild oysters. Instead of letting them, you know, shoot their gonad out, we just took the gonad and then made, you know, took away all those other variables like tides, wind, predators, all that stuff. So it's really, really cool what they can do with oysters. And it, you know, really speaks to the sustainability of it. You know, there's, with the sustainability, there's kind of two issues that we have with oysters or with seafood. There's people are afraid that commercial fishermen, okay, are going to lose work if there's other people doing sustainable seafood. Well, the good news is that the population is growing so much, and in this country, we don't eat a lot of seafood. So the commercial fishermen can keep commercially fish, okay? And they've done a really good job with regulations and keeping fish stocks the way they are in North Carolina. And then other guys, oyster farmers and people that do like hybrid striped bass with NC State, delicious striped bass, really good stuff, okay? Not genetically modified, no antibiotics, nothing, okay? Really good stuff. People that can do that over here. And we can use these people, the sustainable farmers, we can use that for all the growing population that's happening now and the people that are new into seafood and all that, while still letting commercial fishermen, not letting them, because it's, you know, we should be thankful for what they do. So with them still doing that as well, you know, oysters are the most sustainable, least environmentally impacting proteins, animal proteins in the world, right? An oyster is healthy and we don't have to feed it or anything. It filters water. And, you know, we can take 20 out of the wild and put back in 280,000. Those 280,000 we put on the farm, those oysters are regular oysters. They will spawn. They will shoot out sperm and egg. And so we'll have many, many oysters that are going to come from that initial 20, ones that we're going to have on our farm that we're going to bring to y'all. Okay. And then ones that are just going to be out there in the wild, filtering water, providing crucial habitat for juvenile fish, cleaning the water so more sunlight can come down, and then other marine, you know, flora can grow and put oxygen in the water. It's an amazing cycle. And I kind of really talked about a lot of stuff because, you know, and it stinks because we could have really gone in with the cycle of oysters, what they do, how they're keystone species, stuff like that. But you can reach out to me anytime. The number on the website is the best way to get up with me. You can reach out anytime. We'll talk seafood. We'll talk lobster tariffs. Okay. Going into China, we can talk oysters. We can talk polyploidy. If you're a really big nerd, we can talk all that stuff. So hit me up anytime. One more thing I didn't mention about what we do on our farm specifically that makes us unique. We're the only farm in the country that when you order oysters from us, we pull them out that day and then we deliver to you anywhere in North Carolina. So if you're in Charlotte, if you're in Greensboro, if you're in Roanoke Rapids, if you're in Wilmington, all right, if you're in Rural Hall, North Carolina, or Waxhaw, we deliver there. And it's free. It's free delivery anywhere in North Carolina. There's no minimum. If you want two oysters and you live in Roxboro, all right, I'll bring you two oysters. It'll be $2. That's it. $1 an oyster. We do that because we want to provide North Carolinians with fresh North Carolina seafood. And that means all North Carolinians, not people that have money. We're talking about all North Carolinians. Okay. So, you know, we keep it affordable. And if you have an issue with transportation, then we bring them to you. All right. So you know, all week we get orders. Hey, I want 13 oysters. I want, you know, 600 oysters for an oyster roast. We get that all week. The days that we deliver, let's say, you know, people wanted this March 7th. March 7th, we go out, we harvest the oysters, we take a picture and a video with a timestamp. All right. We text you that picture and video so you know we pulled them out of the water that day, and then we just drive them straight to you. All right. We want people, all North Carolinians, we want you to have access to this really great fishery we have here. And we want you to have access to healthy food, right? Fresh seafood as well. And it's difficult. It's difficult getting it from here all the way over here. But, you know, I think it's worth it. And we're really proud of the work we've done. So thanks for listening. I'd love to answer some questions.
Ryan, we have so many questions for you.
Great. Great. And again, guys, if we run out of time, we're probably going to run out of time, right? Just call me. Okay. Another thing too, we're still taking orders for this weekend. If you want any oysters this weekend, if you're like, you know, got you in the mood for oysters, we're going to be harvesting oysters tomorrow. Normally we cut off maybe like Thursday at midnight, but we're going to be harvesting oysters tomorrow, Saturday, whenever. And we'd be happy to bring you some oysters. So
and I dropped your website into the chat. So hopefully folks can find that.
Nice. A nice little plug.
Guys,
we're redoing our website's okay, but we're redoing our website. It's going to come out, I think, on Monday. So, you know, if you take a look at it tonight, definitely come back and take another look at it again. It's going to be really cool.
Okay. So we have so many questions. Let's jump in. the first one is it safe to eat oysters in all months? I have heard not to eat them in certain months.
Oh,
what do you advise?
Yeah, that's a great question. Thank you for asking that, because I know a lot of people on here are probably wondering the same thing. Okay. So there's a couple of things to think about with this. Why is, you know, again, there's a lot of misinformation about oysters. There's a lot of mystique about them, but that brings misinformation. So thank you for asking that question. The reason that there is this thought about oysters not being safe to eat in months without R. So we're talking June, July, May, right? August. So hot months, according, you know, for in our state, hot months, right? So, you know, when people were really crushing oysters in the 1800s, this is before modern refrigeration. So somebody might get sick due to handling, not really for the oyster coming out of the water, but for how it's handled after it's out of the water. Okay, Vibrio vulnificus, VV, all right, Vibrio vulnificus, that's the disease that's the pathogen that gets in your blood that causes all kinds of issues. That's in all water, okay? It really goes down, the percentage really goes down north of 30 parts per thousand. So like kind of where our range is, it really can't grow very well there, but it's in all oysters. So if you've eaten a raw oyster or any kind of undercooked seafood or handled fish or handled shrimp, crabs, you've had Vibrio on you. It's just in a small amount. And you know, if you don't have any kind of immune disorder, HIV, hepatitis C, something like cirrhosis, if you don't have something like that, then you're gonna be completely fine ingesting even large levels of it, okay? After the oyster's out of the water and it heats up, if you just let that thing sit out there for 2 or 3 days, okay, that Vibrio is going to multiply in there, and that's what can get you sick. So these are before there was all these rules and regs and before modern refrigeration. All right. So modern refrigeration came around about 120, 115 years ago. It's safe to eat oysters year around. 100%. I've eaten them right out of the water. Water is 78 degrees in July. Eat them right out of there. Completely safe. Another reason why people think that is because of the wild harvest. So they stop the wild harvest depending on the year, right? They stop the wild harvest about March, April, right before the summer, and then it picks up in October. Okay, the reason they do that is so to let these oysters propagate. When the water warms up, that's how they know to propagate. Okay, so when the water's warming up, slowly warming, the oyster's sensing that, the gonad is building even stronger, right? A nice spring growth. And then it's gonna eject its gonad, sperm or egg. Okay. So they want to give the wild stocks time to replenish and come back. That's why they stopped the wild harvest. So you can eat oysters safely and deliciously 365 days. Think about this. The oyster doesn't know that it's April 15th and we're cutting out wild harvest, right? So you can eat it the 14th and it'd be fine. And then you can eat it the 16th and it'd be fine. So, you know, it's not running on a Gregorian calendar, right? So yeah, that's a great question. Thank you for asking.
The next question is, do you have to take steps to prevent oysters from developing pearls, or do farm conditions naturally prevent them?
Oh, cool question. So we think of oysters as an oyster, right? But there's actually many, many species of oysters around the world. Most oysters that pearl aren't really necessarily true oysters, but they're mostly in the Pacific Ocean near Asia, so Southeast Asia. And so again, we won't get into like species name, Crass ostrea, regular ostrea, Udellus, all these different things. We're not gonna get into that, but true oysters like what we grow here, Castro Strea virginicas, again, the eastern oyster, so all up and down our east coast and in the Gulf of Mexico, that's the species of oyster. They don't really pearl. What they do, all right, if you look at an oyster, right, on the outside of the shell, calcium carbonate, really rough, hard, sharp, okay? Inside the shell, nice and smooth, right? So the way an oyster does that is on the inside, that smooth, shiny surface, that's called nacre. Okay, N-A-C-R-E, that's called nacre. And that's what a pearl's made out of. So you might shuck an oyster, an eastern oyster, Crass ostrea virginica, like we have that you would eat in a restaurant here. And if a piece of mud or any irritant, right, a piece of sand got in there underneath the mantle and in that nacre, you're gonna see nacre grow over it. So it's gonna look like a pearl that is stuck on something. So it's not gonna be round and it's not gonna be able to take it out. It's just going to look like a pearl sitting kind of on top. Now, if you want to watch YouTube videos of pearling oysters, you'll see really neat things. They do everything from, you know, kind of producing the animal to grow multiple pearls, or you'll see, like, if you go to the dentist and you get those things that keep your mouth open, they'll actually open an oyster, put those things on it, okay, and then put an irritant in there. And then as the oyster is growing and the nacre is growing around that, they'll actually open it back up, put those things in, and like move the pearl to make it a uniform circle. It's really fascinating stuff. It's really neat. And then you wouldn't eat those oysters. So we're kind of like, we don't have pearls in our oysters really very much, but you can eat our oysters. So, you know, we'll take it. Great question.
That's so awesome. Wow. Okay, so I think you touched on this before, but how long does it take to grow an oyster to harvest slash market size?
So, you know, these are animals. So, you know, we're a small to medium farm, and we have about 150 to 200,000, about 150 to 300,000 oysters out there at any given time. And we have to think, like I said, these are animals. So the way to think about it is kind of like a bell curve, okay? You're going to have 20% that are fast growers. Again, just like animals or people, 20%. Now those people are gonna hit, those oysters are gonna hit market size in anywhere from 10 to 12 months. So really fast growers, maybe they're in the right part of the cage where a lot of flow is coming through. So those are gonna be 10 to 12 months. Then 60%, that bell curve, 60% right here, okay. Those are going to be about 14 to 18 months. So most of the oysters are going to take anywhere from a year to a year and a half to grow. Okay. So that'd be a general answer. And then the bell curve, again, the last part, 20%, those are the slow growers. Those are going to take about 2 years. We've got oysters on our farm that are 3 years old that are that big. They're an inch and a half, 2 inches. And I don't think they're getting any bigger, but they're alive and they're still filtering water. So we're still going to take care of them. Because, you know, it helps, but, you know, again, it's hard. Sometimes we don't think about them as animals, right? Because they don't have a central nervous system. Maybe some people think they're vegan. they're sessile, they don't have eyes, all these different things, but they are actually animals. So yeah.
The next question is, can you compare and or contrast your oysters to stump sound oysters?
Yeah, sure. So stump sound is great. I love stump sound. I love all North Carolina oysters. But stump sound oysters are wonderful. If, for those of you who don't know, stump sound is north of Wilmington, south of Carteret County, kind of in this part, okay, of the state. And there's a lot of really good oyster farmers there. There's a lot of good wild oysters coming out of there. That area, depending on where you are, right? So if stump sound is kind of faced like this, it's kind of a body of water like this. Okay. If you're towards an inlet up here in the north part, your oyster is going to taste different than if you're down in the lower part. Okay. So kind of comparing them, I would say generally that area is going to be lower salinity than what we have, but the oysters, all the oysters out of there are great. And I'm going to name some guys out of there. Ryan Gaddow. Okay. Three Little Spats oysters. They're really good. There's a guy named Tom Cannon. We work with him a lot with Soundside oysters. They're delicious. So I guess the best way to describe it is ours are going to be generally saltier than that. But, you know, there's rain. There's all kinds of environmental things that would kind of affect it week to week or area to area. But yeah, I love stump sound oysters. And if you do too, keep eating them. They're great.
The next question is, does the government protect the oyster farming bay areas around Harker's, you know?
Yes. So the way I'll kind of answer it roundabout. So the way that a lease works is you lease the water. In North Carolina, the water is a public trust. All of us own it if you're a North Carolina citizen. But what you do as an oyster farmer is you lease water from the state, whether you're so there's some wild harvest guys that do it. Oyster farmers do it. You're leasing that from the state. In terms of protecting waters around Harker's Island for oysters, kind of the way they do that is limiting how many wild oysters are going to come out. So for instance, like we talked about the harvest period, right? You're not going to harvest during the summer months when they're trying to propagate. So that would be a way that they kind of keep those stocks coming. And there are really, really good oysters and a lot of oysters, all right, coming out of that area. So they're doing a really good job. I'm going to mention one thing too. I'm involved with some different organizations, but there's something called an oyster highway that they do for restoration and things like that, where they actually take a long river, okay, and they put oysters at the mouth of it. And then theoretically, okay, those oysters are going to shoot the gonad and sperm and make baby oysters. And that's going to flow up the river or maybe down, depending on where they put them. And then that's going to propagate another oyster reef here. And then those are going to do, and it's going to go all the way up the river. It's really cool stuff. There's a lot of really smart people working on oyster restoration. And there's plenty of oysters out there. I talked to someone at the boat ramp yesterday. He's killing it. There's lots of really delicious wild oysters out there, and they're doing a really good job with keeping the stocks the way they should be, in my opinion.
So many questions about whether or not you offer tours of your farm.
Yeah.
People would love to visit.
Yeah, you guys come on out. So it's $75 a person. And what I tell people is just, you get to get as many oysters as you want, okay? You want to harvest oysters, come harvest as many as you want, $75. If the weather is nice, we can take kayaks out there. Or if the weather's nice and you don't want to kayak 3/4 of a mile, we'll just throw you on the skiff. We'll take it out there. We'll either, again, it kind of depends on what you want to do. Do you want to sit in the boat and look? Do you want to get out and get muddy and get some cuts? Kind of whatever you want to do. So we offer all that stuff. And it's really fun. A lot of times we have two couples, and it's a blast, seeing both relationships and people working out there. It's really fun. Love to have you guys come on out. Just call me, and we do most of our tours during the week.
Next question, or looking for some tips on how to open oysters the best way.
Oh, it's great. I've got an oyster shucker really close by. I know it's kind of a faux pas to stand up. I'm going to go grab it real quick. Okay. This oyster shucker is the one I like to use. It's a Dexter. All right. Comes with a lifetime warranty. What you do, the best way to think about it, if I had an oyster, I could show you a little better. Okay. The oyster is going to have a cup like this. Okay. Anterior side of the oyster, posterior side. On the hinge, it's a bivalve, right? So it's like this. Really, it'd probably be like that with the cup. Okay. The hinge is the back part right here. You're going to slide the knife right there in there. Okay. And if you can get the knife to stand up on its own, you're pretty much already there. Okay. Once you've done that, you're going to push down and twist at the same time. You don't need to beast it. All right. You don't need to like really get in there, you know, after getting in the weight room or anything like that. Once it's up like that, you already know it's in between the two hinges and you can just twist it like that and it's going to pop right open. Okay. It's going to pop right open. A lot of times people go through the lip. So again, you know, oysters like that, instead of coming in that hinge, you can come through the lip. You can take your knife, knock a part of the lip off, and there should be a little opening. Shove it in there, cut that abductor muscle, and you're good to go.
Awesome. Another question about maximizing your experience eating oysters. How do you eat a raw oyster? Do you chew it? Do you let it slide down your throat? What is the best way to go about eating it?
Oh, man. I know I'm loving all these questions, but I really like this one too. So do not, I mean, you can do whatever you want. Okay. I'm not going to tell you how to do anything, but chew your oyster. All right. It's food. I talk to people all the time and they're like, yeah, I can't really just like slurp it down. And it's like, why, you know, why would you, what thing would you put in your mouth that you would want to eat without chewing? So, the way I had my first oyster is on a cracker with some cocktail sauce, some lemon and some hot sauce. And when you put it on the cracker, you chew it and it's really delicious. So that's a good way to eat oysters. That's probably my favorite way to eat a raw oyster, is putting it on a cracker. You know, people want to, you know, they see our oysters and they're, you know, they're on the fancier end. And so they don't want to put anything on it. You know, eat a couple without anything. And then the rest, throw them on some crackers, put them in some cocktail sauce, horseradish, and it's going to be great.
Our last question, or winding down, where can people find your oysters? We've had questions about Carteret County. We've had questions about Beaufort, around Harker's. We've had questions about Raleigh. Where can we find you?
Cool. So, you know, the best way to find me is just to call me. We deliver these to your house. I know it kind of seems like a weird thing or something that's kind of maybe too good to be true, but we drop these oysters off at your house. We don't sell anything outside of North Carolina. If you're outside the state, we don't sell to you. We want our oysters to be eaten by North Carolinians. So we will drive to wherever you live, Little Washington, you know, Harker's Island. We'll drive anywhere you want, and we'll drop them off. We work with one restaurant in North Carolina as well. It's Heron's at the Umstead. So it's North Carolina's only five-star AAA, Forbes 101 best restaurants in the world. They do really, really cool stuff with our oysters, and we provide oysters to them. That's the only restaurant we work with. So if you eat oysters at Heron's in Cary, all those oysters came from us.
That's awesome. Brian, thank you so much for this incredible presentation. I learned so much. All the folks in the chat are saying that they learned so much. What a wonderful presentation. Thank you so much.
Thank you for having me a lot, Mrs. Smith, and cheers to y'all.
So thank you guys for joining us. We hope that you enjoyed this evening. We hope to see you at our next History and Mocktails, St. Patrick's Life and Legacy, happening on March 11th with Dr. Charles Livingston from NC State University. Until that time, everybody take care. Have a wonderful evening. We'll see you soon. Bye, guys.
Bye, guys.